Welcome to this service at Faith and Victory Church. This is the place to come to receive your miracle from God. Now, let's join our service already in progress.
There is in this hour a cry of the Spirit. You know, the Spirit of God cries out to those who listen. You know, Jesus said one time, he said, "He that hath ears to hear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches." What John was saying in that book of Revelation. "But he that has ears to hear, let him hear." How many are listening? Are you listening to the voice of the Holy Ghost? Amen. Hallelujah. All right, I mean, the Spirit of God say. Now listen, you got men saying stuff. You got devils saying stuff. You got devils using men to say stuff. But God's saying things. And he's crying, his Spirit's crying out and looking for the people to hear his voice. That's right. Amen. And not only hear his voice, adhere to and obey his voice. Too much of what we're doing in the church now is worldly minded, success motivated. In other words, we've adopted the definition of success from the world, and we're trying to be successful according to world standards. Let me say this. If you're trying to achieve worldly success, you're going to end up adopting worldly methods. Amen. We are the church. We are led by the Spirit of God. They that are led by the Spirit of God are the sons of God. Amen. That means you got to hear his voice. Somebody shout, "Amen, glory." And if you don't like any of that, just say, "Help me, Jesus." Hallelujah. Amen. The Spirit of God is continuing to cry out what the Lord's been crying out all along. Amen. We're to be followers of Jesus. We're to go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. We're to emulate and act like, be doers of the word. We're to walk like him. We're to talk like him. Amen. Amen. You know, my first sermon I ever preached was from the scripture that says, "He who says he abides in him ought also so to walk even as he walked." Amen. Now, Jesus walked in righteousness. Jesus walked in holiness. Jesus walked in integrity. Jesus walked a life in obedience and in sensitivity to the voice of the Spirit. Because he said this, "The things that I do, I only do them because I see the Father do them." Amen. He was staying in contact with the Father by the Holy Ghost. Amen. Amen. Now we got people coming along trying, you know, want to give a method here and a method there and a cool slick thing here and a cool slick thing there. And they're not hearing the voice of the Spirit. They're counting the number of butts in the seats. Excuse me, I shouldn't say it that way. Back ends in the seats. Amen. Are you here? And because they got enough back ends in the seats, then they're successful. But are they doing what God said? I know of one church that said this: if you're coming here to be discipled, you're coming to the wrong place. They're one of the biggest, fastest growing churches in America. But if you're coming here to be discipled, you're in the wrong place. We're just about winning people to Jesus. Amazing that the head of the church said, "Go make disciples of all men." You don't get a different commandment than what he said already here. And so we have to come back to the place of obedience to the voice of the Spirit, which is always in line with the voice of the Word. Amen. And do what the Word says. Because we want to experience his manifest presence. We want to come into our, we should be wanting and desiring that we'll be coming to our church buildings and we're sitting in worship and we're being ministered the Word, that the fragrance of the glory of the Lord is on us. Amen. So that when we go into the world, they could smell it in the Spirit. Now, my wife bought me a few years ago a cologne. She switched my cologne. That's what she did. I used to wear, Cool Water by Devedorf. Yeah, used to wear Cool Water. Well, she was somewhere and she found this new Versace called Eau Fraiche. Fresh water is what it means. It's French for fresh water. I could put it on in the morning, and I could go in the food line at 5 o'clock in the afternoon. And the cashier goes, "You smell good." Everywhere I go, I'm getting, "You smell good." You see, when you get a fragrance on you, even though you think it's worn off, others around you who have never smelled that before can smell it. And I'm telling you, when you get into the presence of God and you get into His glory, hallelujah, you may walk out of here and you don't think it's there, but those out in the world who haven't been around that before can smell the fragrance of His glory on your life. Amen. Hallelujah. And they won't be saying, you smell good. They'll be saying, can you help me? Glory to God. In the year that King Uzziah died. I love this passage. See, I don't have enough room back here behind me. Because who knows, I might, like Brother Hagin, you say, take off and have an East Texas Brush Arbor spell. Now that's the same thing as an Eastern North Carolina Piney Grove spell. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Piney Grove camp meeting. The Pentecostal Holiness Church has a camp meeting down in Eastern Carolina called Piney Grove, outside of the big city of Grimesland, North Carolina, which is near Little Washington. Or Washington. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord. I now my wife told me not to say anything, but I've got to say something. I'm not going to call any names. But somebody from a very large ministry, television ministry, got up this and got and went viral on Facebook and got up and said, worship is not for God. Worship is for you. Because when you worship, you're happy, and what makes God happy is for you to be happy. So worshiping God is really not for God, it's for you. Somebody took that and then took a clip from a Bill Cosby television show. And they played that clip, and they came back and played the clip from Cosby. And he gets up and goes, that's the dumbest thing I've ever heard. And everybody's going, I concur with Dr. Bill. Oh, my, it was the dumb. You know, here, this is what happens here. Let's see if it's all about him. I saw the Lord high and lifted up, and His train, that's His glory. Oh, my. Our churches need more manifest presence of the glory of God. We don't need another rock climbing wall. We need the glory. I don't care if you got one, but that's not what we need. We need the manifest presence of the glory of God in our services. People need to come in and be touched by the glory. They need to be transformed by the glory. Hallelujah. I mean, those guys woke up and they saw Jesus and Moses and Elijah, hallelujah, transfigured in the glory of God manifest, so much so that Jesus' garments became shining as the bright noonday sun. Hallelujah. The glory of God. Moses came out of the presence. They had to put a veil on his face that people couldn't stand to look upon him. It was so bright. The world is sinking deeper and deeper into darkness, deeper and deeper into sin, deeper and deeper into bondage. And our churches are playing games. Christians are playing games. We're trying to be slick. We're trying to be cool. We're trying to be hip. What we need to be is anointed. Amen. With the presence and the glory of God. I'm not, listen, no, don't think I'm throwing the baby out the bathwater. I don't mind cool music. I don't mind, you know, but when we're depending on the slick and the cool and the image, and we're not depending on the glory, something is wrong. Because when Isaiah spoke, he said that the yoke shall be destroyed and the burden removed because of your slickness. Because you were cool, because you were hip. No, he said it will be destroyed because of the anointing. The yoke shall be destroyed off of thy neck and the burden removed because we came into the presence of God and we worship God to worship God, not so we can make Him happy because we're happy. Amen. We came out of His glory. We were changed by His presence. Isaiah goes on and says here, His train filled the temple and there were seraphims. There were six wings. Two, they covered their face. Two, they covered their feet. And with two, they did fly. And they just kept crying back and forth one to the other, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of His glory. Now, I'm going to say something here. I've heard a lot of big preachers say grandiose things about what they would do if Jesus showed up, about how cocky they were. I want to tell you something. Every time I read somebody in the Bible that saw Jesus, they fell at their feet. I don't care who they were. They may have been the righteousness. We know they may have been born again, the righteousness of God in Christ, full of the Holy Ghost. But when Jesus shows up, you fall at his feet. I want you to know right now that every few minutes, the four beasts and the 24 elders get up, take off their crowns, throw him at his feet, and begin to cry out, "Worthy is the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world." They don't get up and say, "Well, we're cool. We got a throne seat." No. Every little while, they just can't take it anymore. Why? Because of the presence of the glory of him who was and is to come, the glorious one, the Almighty, the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning and the end, he who was and is to come. Glory to God. The Lamb that was slain, and yet he's alive. He's the Alpha, the Omega. He's the first, the last. He's not the one who was. He's the one who was. He's the one who is. And he's the one who is to come. He's the one and the only one worthy enough to take the book and to open the seals thereof. And you're going to tell me, you're just going to, "What's up, Lord? Hey, dude, what's going on?" You're arrogant. That's arrogance. He is the King of Kings. He is the Lord of Lords. Heaven. Oh, glory to God. And hell. What did the Bible say? What did it say? That every knee shall bow of things in heaven and things in the earth and things beneath the earth. And they'll confess he is Lord to the glory of God the Father. I want you to know heaven, earth, and hell all bow their knee at the coming of his presence. Oh my. Erosoko manabadekita. He cried, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. And the post of the doors moved at the voice of him that cried. The house was filled with smoke." Isaiah's seeing this. I mean, he's seeing all this. And he said, "Then said I, hey, Lord, this is cool. I like it. Now, I'm not going to worship you because it's for you. I'm going to worship you because that's going to make me happy. And because I'm happy, you're happy." He said, "Woe is me, for I am a man of unclean lips and dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. And mine eyes have seen the King of the Lord of hosts." I'm telling you, we think we know what the glory's like. Anything we've experienced is only a tad, a little smidget, just a brief encounter of his presence. Great is the glory of the Lord. The Bible said, Isaiah said, he said, the whole earth is full of his glory. Hallelujah. When Abraham awoke from that deep sleep and saw a smoking furnace walking between the sacrifices, the glory of God had come down in covenant. I do have the right man, don't I? Brother Bill? Abraham, right? Yeah, okay. Just make sure everybody kind of sitting there going, did I mess up? Think about that. He woke up from that sleeping and the God of glory came down and he saw a smoking furnace. The mount glowed with his glory as a fire. So much so that the bush wouldn't burn it when Moses came, which is our next passage. Said, "I will turn aside and see this great sight." Now remember, the angel came and took a tongue off the altar and placed it on Isaiah's lips. Because the Lord said, "Who will go for us?" And the angel kept it with the tongs and took the fire off the coals and placed it on his lips. And he cleansed his lips. And he said, "I'll go. The glory of the Lord is transforming." I said it will transform us. We haven't been spending enough time in the glory. I'm telling you, when you come out of the glory, your faith is stronger. Amen. Why? Because you've been in the presence of him who wrote the book. He's the one that wrote it. You know more of him. Therefore, you understand the character of his word. And the word that you've heard spoken is not just the word that a preacher read or wrote, or read or repeated. But it's the word of the one you've been in his presence of. Now his word has more force in your life. Because you know the one who wrote it.
Right.
Oh, hallelujah. Nathan was right. There's a change. Can I just be honest with you? I woke up this morning at 3:00. And from 3:00 on, the rest of the morning, I doze in the back of the night. I had my iPad open. It's really nice to be able to turn that on and read that in the dark. Had my notes up, and I was looking over the notes and praying in the Holy Ghost. And I look over the notes and pray in the Holy Ghost. Look over the notes, pray in the Holy Ghost. Then I sit down, doze off, wake back up, and then here I am again. I'm like, wide awake. Okay, back, praying in the Holy Ghost. Mm-hmm. Hours. Something stirring in the Spirit. God beckoning us as a people to come back into the glory of God. Be in his manifest presence. That doesn't mean every service is going to be running, shouting, jumping over the chair service. You can be in the manifest presence of God. Somebody stand up and teach a Bible lesson. But let's not get caught up with natural things and have a worship service where, you know, they sing the whole service. Play and sing songs the whole service. It can be just as annoying as getting up and running and shouting. God's not limited to one style.
Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
I've seen the anointing work in Pentecostal churches, and I've seen it in Baptist churches. Amen. Every once in a while, you go over to the Church of the Frozen Chosen, you'll see it over there. I'm being silly now. Now, Moses kept the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock by the backside of the desert. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him in the flame of a bush that burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed. And Moses said, this is Exodus 3:3 now. And Moses said, I will turn aside. Now, here's that cocky guy. I'll turn aside and see this great sight. Yeah, I'm Moses. Hey, dude, I'm really hip in the spiritual things. When you get into the presence of God, you lose your hipness. There is something about the presence of God that removes a demeaning character from you, and it removes an exalted character from you. God said he will bring down the exalted and he'll lift up the humble. What is he going to do? His presence will make you what you ought to be. Amen. Now you understand, we've preached a lot of sermons on feeding on the word, being doers of the word, meditating in the word. This is not outside of that. This is not, okay? It's part of it. But this is what we're talking about. We're talking about his presence right now. That's built on all the other foundation. Okay? So he'll bring down the proud and lift up the humble to bring us all to where we're supposed to be. By getting into his glory. So we saw Isaiah. I mean, he went from, who am I? I'm unclean, to send me. I'll go. Then you got Moses here. I'll turn aside and see the sight. Verse 4, and when the Lord saw that he turned aside, God called out to him out of the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. He said, here am I. He said, draw nigh hither. Put off the shoes from off thy feet, for the place whereon thou standest is holy ground. Moreover, he said, I am the God of thy father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look on God. Now, all of a sudden, now he came out going, cocky, I'm all with it. I got it together. I'm the dude. I'm the man. I'm Moses. God says, Moses, he said, hey, I'm here. Get your shoes off your feet. This is holy ground. And when Moses realized he was not in the midst of a phenomenon, but in the midst of the presence of the glory of God, he hid his face. Because he was afraid to look on him. Hallelujah. I've surely seen the affliction of my people who are in Egypt and have heard their cry by reason of their taskmasters, for I know their sorrows, and I'm come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up, da 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 da. And verse 10, come now therefore, and I will send thee unto Pharaoh, that thou mayest bring forth my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. And Moses said unto him, now remember Isaiah said, who am I? I mean, here, I said, I'm a man of unclean lips. And then when God said, who am I going to send? He said, here am I. Now God shows all this up to Moses. He says, who am I? See, one was debased in his own eyes, and God lifted him up. One was lifted up in pride in his own eyes, and the presence of God brought him down. He says, who am I that I should go unto Pharaoh and should bring forth the children of Israel out of Egypt? Hallelujah. And then you got Saul over in Acts 8. In Acts 9, he was breathing out threat, and he's going against the church, and the Lord appeared to him, and a light shined brighter than the noonday sun, and he knocked him off his horse. And the Lord said, Saul, Saul. And he said, who art thou, Lord? He said, I am Jesus, whom you persecute. And then the next words out of his mouth were, what will you have me to do? The presence of God can melt the hardness of hearts. The most religious can be melted by the presence of God. Now, I always like to call this the Mr. T anointing, because Jesus came for there was two purposes here. Paul had a choice, get saved or go to hell, now. I pity the fool who worked against my church. I mean, you know, I just kind of had that. He knocked him off the horse. You know, he was bringing that threatenings against the church, and Jesus showed up to stop him. Right. Now, Paul, at the time, Saul, was smart enough to say, Lord, what do you want me to do? Because the next thing was, enter in to the reward of your life. Satan is now your eternal master. And he was toast, man. He was toast or heaven. Amen. He chose heaven. The glory of God can transform lives. The glory of God can take you from a sheepish, introverted, not wanting to talk to people. And you come out of that presence and glory of God and say, here am I, send me. And it can take the arrogant who think they know everything and are causing trouble everywhere they go because they're so arrogant. And they get into the presence of God enough, it'll humble them. And they'll begin to say, who am I to bear this and to do this? God's glory. The church. Let me say this. God's not trying to have a revival to pour out his glory. His glory is waiting for the church to open up and receive it. He'll go wherever people are hungry. He'll go wherever people are receptive. He'll go wherever people are beckoning him to come and to manifest himself. Amen. We as a church, I know this. There are places we've walked in the past that we're not walking in now. That the Lord stirred me. Been stirring me for several days. I get alone in my car and I'm driving and God's just stirring me. That there are things we've left behind that we've got to walk in again. But not only walk in them again, but go take them and go into higher places with them. Amen. Hallelujah. Sorakaniski Dabanskoritiska. Fomrayemislikum Madalaragiska. No slip on bande silek and musku uvigamenke. In the glory of God. In the glory of his presence. In that place, you will be able to enlarge your heart, enlarge your vision, enlarge the place of your habitation, and fulfill the purpose. Command of God to you as a body. So set aside your life once again. Be sensitive to me, says the Lord. Entreat my spirit when he visits you. And receive his instruction and his guidance. And once again, walk. Walk in the secret places of the Most High. Walk in the manifest presence of the glory of the Almighty. And see his hand stretched forth to do good among humanity. See their lives changed. for humanity to come to know that the Lord, He is good. He is God. Hallelujah. 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 Glory be to God forevermore. Jude 1:20, but ye, beloved, building up yourselves on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. We know from the book of Corinthians, where Paul wrote to the church at Corinth, that praying in the Holy Ghost is praying in other tongues. You can pray in your natural language and be accurate, can be fervent, be praying with unction, but praying in the Holy Ghost is praying in other tongues. We got to stir ourselves up. I said, we got to stir ourselves up. We got to stir ourselves up. Hallelujah. And we don't come to church and just kind of tune out and, you know, and hope that, you know, maybe something will happen today. And we got to come in tuned. We got to be coming in tuned up. Amen. We got to be coming in fired up. Amen. We got to be coming in out of the presence of God, bringing that with us. Amen. Why? Because through these doors will walk hurting humanity. And we don't have time to have a 5-hour prayer meeting to get in the Spirit.
Amen.
We need to be in the Spirit. Amen. And when they come with their hurts, when they come with their pains, when they come in need of the glory, it's already here. Hallelujah. We used to sing that song, oh, the glory is here. Yes, the glory is here. I can see the presence in the very atmosphere. For whatever you may need, just reach out and receive. And say it's mine. I take it now. And that was horrible. I was way off. I know it wasn't on pitch. I wasn't on tune. I wasn't on anything. What's the words? Thank God we can make glad rackets to the Lord. Amen. But what happens when the glory is here and people come in? They can just reach out and grab, get into that glory. Hallelujah. Oh, Ephesians chapter 5. I had a conversation with my friend this week, my Facebook buddy. Actually, I went to Rhema with him. But I sent the video of that person saying those things about worshiping. I just sent it behind the scenes. I'm not out to just blast people on Facebook. I'm not out to blast a person. But when doctrine is erroneous and egregious, it has to be dealt with. Amen. When things are said that are egregious as far as concerning doctrine, things have to be dealt with. But I sent it to him in the background and I said, any thoughts? Give him my position. That's any thoughts. And he said, yes, many. But he went on down in his response to me and talking to me, and he said this. He said, I have been disconcerted for some time about what's going on. I said, no, he said, this is very disconcerting. Then he went, but I've been disconcerted for some time. And somebody said something this morning. The kid said something in the office. I said, yeah, just like he said, I've been disconcerted also. There are things going on in the church that shouldn't be going on in the church, that we cannot become prey to. And I'm going to read, and this is where Paul talks. He says some things in here. I'm going to share some things out of the Greek, okay? I'm not a Greek scholar, but I got Greek concordances and Greek study guides. All right? Isn't that good? See then, verse 15 of chapter 5, Ephesians chapter 5, verses 15 through 20. I'm talking like Yoda. Scripture we read this is. See then that you walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time, because the days are what? Evil. Wherefore be ye not unwise, but understanding what the will of the Lord is, and be not drunk with wine, wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit, speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, making melody in your heart unto the Lord. Let me go ahead. We're going to break down a couple things here, and then we're not going to keep you much longer. Anybody getting blessed this morning? There's a bidding by the Spirit. It's not a new bidding, but it's a bidding that we're tuning into. It's the bidding of the Spirit to walk in the Spirit. It's a bidding of the Spirit. See, Paul was saying what the Spirit was saying back here. I was concerned. We saw somebody's Facebook post not that long ago, and from a church, a local church, and the pastor's, you know, a real hip pastor. He's out sitting there, and he's at someplace with his beer bottle. And everybody, people just flocking in the church. Other people sitting at the table with their wine. He's got his beer bottle. And my only question is, how do you minister to the guy who you go out on the street and he's got a bottle of Mad Dog 2020? Or got some Richard's Wild Irish Rose wine? Because it's cheap drunk. Can't afford the expenses. He's doing the cheap drunk. How many know what Mad Dog 2020 is? Oh, MD 2020. I don't think it's Mad Dog, but everybody caught it because it made you like a mad dog. Just a cheap drunk. How are you going to minister to him with your beer bottle? Amen. The Lord wants to deliver you. It looks like you're doing the same thing I'm doing. Right. Just you doing it cool. See, it's not going to be the fact that you're hip and got a beer bottle and you can talk to him. It's going to be that fragrance I was talking about. It's going to be the manifest presence of God. Because your coolness is not going to break his yokes and remove his burdens, but the fragrance of the anointing will. The anointing will. Verse 14. Verse 15. The word see, bletpit, is another way of saying watch out, take heed, be very careful. So take heed, watch out, be very careful that you walk how? Circumspectly. That's an old term, it's an old word, and it literally means looking around. You're watching out. Hello? And it really contains the idea, listen to this, I know that a lot of people don't want to hear this, it contains the idea of walking strictly. You walk within parameters of what the word says to walk in. You walk in a way. You don't walk in a way that's displeasing to God and holler grace. Oh, I'm under grace. It don't matter what I do. No, watch out, take heed, walk strictly. Remember Jesus said this. How many remember what Jesus said? Wide is the path that leads, or gate is the path, is a gate that leads to what? Didn't say it led to blessing. Oh, you narrow-minded Bible thumpers. Jesus said, narrow is the way that leads to salvation. Here, he says, watch out and walk strictly. What does that mean? That means you don't test how far you can get away with stuff. Are you here? Now, let me say this. Terrorists are constantly doing dry runs on us. Are you here? They're constantly doing dry runs with us. They're constantly trying to see how far they can go and not get caught. Because ultimately, they want to run a real test and blow us up. The devil is doing the same thing to people's lives. He tries to push you so far and get you to go so far and go, well, I didn't lose my salvation on that one. Why? Because he wants to get you to the precipice and push you off. Sorry, I use that big word. I learned that a few years ago. Somebody was standing on the precipice of something, and Doug Jones, our RMI director, wrote back and said, what is a precipice? And it's the edge. It's the very edge of a cliff kind of thing. You know, it's right out there on the edge. My wife liked to walk right off of one at the Grand Canyon. She was walking, taking pictures, and walked right around the little fence, and it was right there between that little fence and the edge. And I'm on the other side, not even not like oblivious. I mean, she could have gone, psh, and we're going, what happened? The devil's always trying to push us to the limits. Yet the word says, see that you watch out. Amen? That you walk strictly. That's no fun. It ain't about having fun. Now, I grew up a Pentecostal. Came over among the Charismatic Word of Faith group. And there were some things we talked about then about God wants us to have fun, and God wants us to be this, and God wants us to be that. And I'm telling you that a lot of that was good, but if you start taking stuff beyond a certain place, you get into error. You get in excess. So then people start thinking, well, I can do anything I want to in heaven because I'm under grace. Now we got it. It doesn't matter. You can shack up with your girlfriend and fornicate, and that's okay because I'm under grace. Now, you think I'm joking? I pastor that I oversee had people in his church come to him and tell him that. Because they were having, they wanted relationship counseling. And he said, I know what your problem is. You're shacking up together. They said, oh, it don't matter. We're under grace. It does matter. If you want the blessings, don't think you're not going to have problems when you're living outside God's plan. And you're sitting around drinking and smoking and shooting up and all this stuff you want. No, God's saying walk strictly. Now, let me say this. If you're not a Christian, this don't apply. You come just like you are, Jesus will save you. Jesus will redeem you. Amen? Then he'll say, walk strictly. But right now, if you're an unbeliever, we're not going to tell you you got to start living right. You can't live right. You need Jesus. So I'm not condemning you. I'm talking to church folk. He that saith he abideth in him also so to walk even as he walked. Amen? Okay. The next verse, verse 16, where he says, redeeming the time for the days are evil. The present participle in this verse is middle voice and refers to purchasing for oneself or one's personal benefit on a continuous basis. Okay, you're redeeming. You're buying back those days. Okay? The days are evil speaks of evil in active opposition to that which is true. If Christians are not careful, listen to this. This is a commentary on this. If Christians are not careful, then what am I talking about? I've been talking about being in the presence of God. Paul says, be not drunk. He goes on and starts saying, then he comes back and says, but be filled with the Spirit. Be not, you know, but drunk with wine, be filled with the Spirit. Okay, that's where he's going to finish up here. If Christians are not careful, the evil nature of this age will rob them of the opportunity to do God's will. So if we don't stay strict, if we don't stay in line, if we don't keep a watch and stay on line with God's plan, what will happen is we'll begin to adopt the mindset of the world. Just like the Bible says. Remember what the Bible said about Lot? How many remember what the Bible said about Lot? When Lot went into Sodom, and he was in Sodom, and he was living there, the Bible says this, that what was going on in that city vexed his righteous soul daily. So much so, when the men of the city came to get the angels who were getting ready to cook them, because they wanted to have relationships with them, because there was such perversion, that the man offered them his daughters. Now, some group show up at my house to try to get my daughters. Nathan has the best theft deterrent system in the world. The sound of a shotgun. Just them hearing that go, shkukup, runs most folks off because they notice. Hallelujah. You show up at my house for my daughters, you're going to leave with some lead in the backside. If you had time to turn around. Or you may not leave. And then if you leave, we're getting some shotgun lead. I'm going to have him sitting up in the window with his 7 mag and his scope out of 100 yards and take you down. You're not getting my daughters. His soul was so vexed, he offered his daughters to a perverse mob to do whatever he would with them. The Bible says he vexed his righteous soul daily. The days are evil. And that's what here. Paul says this, see that you walk strictly. Why? The days are evil. If we don't keep ourselves in the presence of God, they'll vex your soul. And you'll begin to think you can do things that you can't do. And you'll begin to think you can live ways that you can't live. And you'll be thinking you can get away with stuff that you can't get away with. And you'll become ineffective for the Father. God wants us as effective tools in his hands. And what makes him happy is your obedience to walk according to his word. Not that you came to church and worshiped yourself happy to make him happy. Verse 17. Wherefore, be not understanding, but what the will of the Lord is. It says, doing God's will cannot become a reality in a person's life unless they understand what God's will is. Amen? Actually, he says, be ye not unwise in this verse. Comes from another present imperative, which, listen to this, prohibition. And it literally means this. Now it says, be not unwise as fools, I think it is. Be not unwise, understand what the will of the Lord is. He says, the Greek actually means this. Stop becoming those who are foolish. Not just don't be unwise. Oh, I'm not going to be unwise, I'm going to be wise. No, he says, stop becoming those who are foolish. How do you become foolish? Get out of his presence. Get out of his glory. Get into your own thing. Begin to justify whatever you want to do. Not letting the presence and the glory of God. I'm telling you right now. Somebody came to me a number of years ago. And they were going to start these vending machines where you sold cigarettes in them. All right? And they thought, well, I can make a lot of money and tithe to the Lord. And they want to know what I thought. Of course, see, the hook is there. They're going to tithe a lot of money. Well, instead of having an argument, I got out of the light, you know. I'm in the light. Anyway. Turn on your television tonight because I'm in. Anyway, hallelujah. Laugh, church. Come on. When I do a funny, if I think it's funny, you laugh. Make me feel good. All right? Hallelujah. Where was I before I got off on that? Yeah. So instead of arguing with him, because you're going to go back and forth, the Bible doesn't say anything about selling cigarettes and cigarette machines. No, it doesn't. The Bible says that the works of the flesh are such like. You didn't list all the works of the flesh. And I looked at him and said, okay, here, I'll tell you what you do. Thank God for wisdom that comes from the Holy Ghost. I said, go ahead. Go get you all the cigarettes for these machines. Walk up to the machines. Open them up. Open up all those cartons of cigarettes you're going to stick in there. And I said, now before you put one single one in there, say, Lord, I put these in this machine to sell for your glory. Came back the next week. Looked at me and said, I got it. I said, what? I said, I couldn't do it. When I said, Lord, I do this for your glory, I couldn't do it. Because I knew it didn't honor him. But see, the devil will tell you, but you'll get lots of money. You'll give it to the church. You'll be a blessing while you're killing folk. Right. That makes a lot of sense. Why don't we just say we're going to rob the bank and take and tithe of what you rob? Really? Go rob the bank. Whatever you get for your haul, tithe. Or, Lord, I rob this bank for your glory. You're going to get 10% of it. At least give the 10% that doesn't have the dye on it. So they can't trace it. Hallelujah. So it literally says, or it says, be not unwise. It says, stop becoming those who are foolish. Now listen to that. That must have meant they were in the act of becoming foolish. If he says, stop becoming those. Why? Because they weren't doing what he said here. Actually, verse 14, it said, wake from thou that sleepest and arise from the dead, for Christ shall give thee light. See that you walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time because the days are evil. Be not unwise, but understanding what the will of the Lord is. Verse 18, be not drunk with wine, wherein is excess. Be filled with the Spirit. You got a bunch of people running around the country. I am telling you, it's like an epidemic in America. Actually, it started in Europe. I went to Estonia. It's been about 10 years ago, I guess, now. And last time I went in, and this is the same group of people who came out of revival after the fall of the Soviet Union. These people were on fire for God. I preached them and taught them in Bible school. They went out and started churches. They had a fire for God. When I came back this last time, all they wanted to talk about was, is it okay to drink wine? They had been studying to find out if it was all right to drink wine. And I got a question for you. Why? Why are you looking for permission to go do something that you're having to try to prove it's okay to do? There's an epidemic in the church of the coolness of drinking and being a Christian. Some people call them educated Christians. The Native Americans didn't call alcohol spirits for nothing. Amen. And even in some things, you know, when there's really hard liquor, they call it spirits. It's not even referred to as alcohol, it's referred to as spirits. Duh! The world's got more sense than church folk. Come on now. I know you don't really understand this, but it's cool. I don't care. My wife got me turned on to getting pedicures and manicures. Now my fingernails are shiny. There is no polish on my fingernails. They buffed them. My nails are so cool. They buff shiny. They're buff. But I never took care of either my fingernails. I hate to tell you this. I had a horrible habit of biting my nails. My brother bites his so bad he has to turn them backwards so he can get a better grip on them and take them further up, further down. Okay? So I'm in there, you know, they're doing my nails. I've already had my feet done. I love it. I get in that machine and it massages me for 30 minutes up, you know, up and down your back. Go ahead. Now they tickle my feet. The balls of my feet are extremely ticklish. I never kick them every time because they'll be going along. Also, they'll hit that spot right in the middle of the ball of my foot. And my other legs over there going like this. You should have one girl, she would just come by if I was laid back waiting for Janie to get in, she'd just come out and tickle my foot. And there I come out, what? I said all that. So we're sitting in there, and these people come in, these ladies come in, and they, you know, they'll give you a free glass of wine or a Coke, and I always take Coke. And she's had a rough week. And they bring her a glass of wine, and she goes, oh, I needed this. Like, it's a drama about the fact you get to drink something. Well, that's the world, but now we got the church. It's cool, so it's all right. I want to find a place that's all right. Here, let me say something here. Above all else, that which makes a Christian life successful and pleasing to God is living in the power of the Holy Spirit. Quoting Proverbs 23:30, Paul warned against the folly of indulging in wine. Bacchus, the wine god, was one of the gods worshipped by the pagans. Therefore, drunkenness was a normal part of pagan life. Apparently, some of the Gentile Christians continued to follow their former practice, even though to them, Bacchus was no longer a god. The command comes here from another present imperative, prohibition, and it could be translated, stop being drunk with wine. Drunkenness only leads to excess or debauchery. Now, some people say, well, see, no, I'm not drunk. That's like having HBO in your house say you don't watch the porn. Y'all got quiet on me. Y'all were shouting earlier in my message. We were talking about the glory on your life. And now, y'all, woo! Don't shut me down just because I'm preaching good. How come me to get off on a thing like this? Don't shut me down just because I'm meddling. If you can't say amen, say oh me. Listen to this. Because here's what Paul's saying. Instead of being filled physically. Now, can I say something? If you need wine to relax you, there's a problem in your life. Because what you should do is go pray in the Holy Ghost and get relaxed by the Spirit of God. Amen. We're living carnally and not spiritually. I just like the taste. Don't ruin your testimony over a taste. Well, it has, red wine has certain, you know, medicinal purposes in your body, and they've proven that red grape juice has more. Huh? What's that? It has more antioxidants than the red wine does. It's better for you than red wine. Right. So there goes that excuse. Just go get the red grape juice. You can drink that by the gallon. And it tastes better. But listen to what Paul says here. I mean, the commentary says here. It says, instead of being filled physically, Paul encouraged Christians to be filled spiritually. And this is what we're really after. Whether, you know, you think there's a Bible that says you can't, and the people say the Bible says it can't. The bottom line is, you should be getting filled up with the Holy Ghost, not getting filled up with the natural spirits of the world. You should be relaxed in the Spirit, not relaxed because of alcohol. Amen? And to add to that, remember Paul wrote Timothy one day and said, don't just drink water, but drink some wine for your stomach's sake, for your altar. It's amazing to me he had to tell him to drink it medicinally and not, you know, back off, dude. Amen. He was staying so far away from it to protect his testimony and everything. Paul said, look, you got to drink some because, you know, the water's bad. Some. A little, actually. Drink a little. Not every meal. Don't advertise on your church website. We do it. Do people do that? Yeah. The command here is from the present passive imperative verb, literally meaning be being filled with the Spirit. Listen to this. It's not optional. And I can tell you, if you stay full of the Holy Ghost, you won't need to be full of anything else. Y'all hear you go home. If you stay full of the Holy Ghost, you won't need to be full of anything else. Praise the Lord. It's not optional. It's passive, denoting that God has to accomplish it. Thirdly, it is present, meaning that it's an ongoing process. God should be working. You should be in a place with God where His presence is on you and you're staying in His presence and He's constantly working in you and filling you with Himself. Instead of you going through your week and getting in your week, you got to have a glass of Chardonnay or, you know, some French wine from the, you know, the whatever raison of France, you got to have these. Provence raison. Now you feel better. And it'll wear off, and there won't be even the lightest scent of the presence of God. So you can minister to others. But you can go get in the presence of God and get saturated with His glory and let the cares of the world float off you like water off a duck's back. And walk out of that place, and the fragrance of God for humanity is on you. It's a big difference. I said, there's Jeff Waxter Carr.
Well, you started talking about your nails today.
Help him, Lord, help him. Be ye being filled. So it's not an option, folks, to be filled with the Spirit. We're to be filled as a commandment. Oh man, I just need this to relax me for the day. I can tell you, if you go get in His presence, you'll get relaxed. You pray in tongues long enough, your mind will still itself. It'll come at peace. The visitation of His presence will engulf you. We're a Holy Ghost church. We ain't been acting like it, but we're acting like it. Again. I don't want to be good about it. You might speak in tongues. Bring them. They've been over to the place that don't teach anything. You may as well bring them to the stuff that teaches everything. Let them get into the glory. Let them encounter God. Let's love on them. You can't come out of His presence without coming out in love. God is love. You stay in His presence and you're just going to be full of His love. Amen. Praise the Lord. Father, we love You. We love Your people. We love the Word of God. We love the Holy Spirit of God. We love the head of the church, the Lord Jesus Christ. We commit to be people of the Spirit today, to be yielded to the Holy Ghost, so that the fragrance of God is on our lives as we go into a hurting world. And they may not know what it is, but they know they want it. Hallelujah. Can I share one more thing with you? I want you to remember back when the disciples were brought and tried and commanded to teach and preach no more in the name of Jesus. But the Bible says this about the council that was interrogating them. So they took note of them. They were ignorant and unlearned men, but they had been with Jesus. There's something about being with Jesus that gets off on you. Hallelujah. I said it gets off on you. Hallelujah. Amen. Glory to God. We're going to, is the mouth of source here?
We trust that you were blessed by the Word of God and the flow of the Spirit of God in this service. If you would like to contact us, please write us via email at office@fvc.org or using our mailing address, P.O. Box 7752, Greensboro, North Carolina, 27417. If you would like to contribute to our ministry, please go to our website at www.fvc.org and click on the Giving Online button. Thank you, and may God richly bless you for your giving.